So now, guys, comes the evaluation session. So for the evaluation session, I will now gladly pass the control over to a gentleman who I met during a recent visit in another Toastmasters club. He is a member of KL Advance and OUM Toastmasters club. I would like to call upon distinguished Toastmaster Mark McKenzie to take over the evaluation session.
Toastmasters and most welcome guests, have you had an inspiring evening?
Yes.
Let's try that again. Are you feeling inspired?
Yes.
Are you feeling excited?
Yes.
Oh, you all sound sleepy. Well, it is indeed a pleasure to be here this evening, and it's a pleasure to be your general evaluator and to offer some pointers as to how well we have done and how well the speakers have done themselves. And the word of the day, commiseration. I do express that for the evaluators since I don't have the evaluated speeches. All right. So we're going to get into the evaluation segment now, and I'm going to just use the evaluators in the order in which they're shown on the agenda, as against confusing myself with the names. So I'll take the first evaluator for the last speaker, right?
Yes.
Alan.
All right?
Yes. Alan. Alan is the first evaluator, right?
Yes, correct.
For the last speaker. Yes, so let's invite Alan to the lectern to give his evaluation. Where's the board? There. Oh. Yes.
Thank you, General Evaluator, for making sure that I work well in spite of the flurry. So in delivering bad news, Chris had an arduous challenge because she was supposed to show commiseration. And if you know Chris, she has got this expressive self about her. It is hard for her not to smile every 5 minutes. So I was watching intently, how is she going to be delivering bad news? And I could see that restraint from Chris as she had a serious posture about her, because the topic at hand was retrenchment. And it's hard to smile at this when people's livelihood will be affected. But I find that Chris was able to weave a good story together. She talked about it's the government, right? It is the immigration laws, and it's because of this there'll be less demand, and because of that, teachers' jobs will be impacted. I found that she was very careful with the words she used. She used the words we. She tried to be as inclusive as possible. She even leveraged on another senior member of her faculty. You could see that from a speech perspective, she was really trying to show empathy, trying to win the crowd over. I would say that ultimately in relaying bad news, this is bad news, right? You can't sell optimism all the time. And my point for greater dissertation, I hope you don't ever have to use this speech, but if you do have to, the thing that I'm trying to predict here is things were left so well in a flurry, because if I was there in the room, I find that I would have been sizzled with hope that yes, this person of mine called Chris is gonna really fight very hard for my job, and she's gonna do all that she can, and hopefully that I will be spared. But I find that to push this further, reality needs to set in. Because after all, jobs will be affected. And I also find that the pinpoint to the fact that it is actually management could actually dilute the seriousness of the matter. For me, I think one level up in relaying this bad news would be to just tell them how you really care. You actually said that you care for them, but when someone's potentially gonna lose their job, no amount of words can share that through. Practical approach to say that, you know what, it is really out of my control, but for each of you, if you need that referral letter, let me know. If I need to stay back to speak to your would-be employees, let me know. Now, these kind of things mean a lot because these are practical suggestions. I'm taking this opportunity to critique this because I know Chris can take it. If you're going to do a check in the box exercise, which is a term I use all the time, you would have passed all the flavor, right? So in a serious moment like this, it's not just to sell the optimism and to lead people on a high, but to tell them practically how we're going about it. gonna do this. But that she did say that you should all look out for jobs elsewhere. My only gripe was it was so superfluous. It was so well done that as a bystander, I felt that maybe I wouldn't be impacted. So there was a degree of hope there. You executed your words nicely. You were positive. You were professional. You were respectful. But I ask that those of us who may one day have to do this, put that a practical solution out.
Chris, that's an excellent evaluation that you received. I spent the last 2 or 3 minutes of your speech actually searching up for the project itself. There are two approaches to deliver bad news. It's the direct approach and the indirect approach. I couldn't fit your speech or the message that you were delivering into whether or not you were using the direct approach or the indirect approach. For management, it's best suited that bad news, it is just be direct. Because what we don't want to do is to leave people with false hope. We're probably doing more damage than good if we leave people with false hope. So if you ever have to do that project again, I would suggest that you have a good look at the when is it appropriate to use an indirect approach versus the direct approach. But other than that, this is the second time I'm hearing you speak. You are always smiling, always upbeat, but I don't think when you have bad news to deliver, that's what you're saying. So, thank you. And then our second evaluator is Kai, is it?
GC.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman Evaluator. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to share my thoughts about Johnson's attempt on this assignment. It's an interesting assignment because if you notice there are 3 bits, the initial speech, the role play, and the debrief. The core of this assignment is actually revolves around the scenario, the role play itself, because that's a real thing. So I'm going to share my thoughts. So the opening part, I thought it was done very smoothly. Typical Johnson, smooth, polished, it's a discourse of conversations and the techniques is very well done, very well mastered, precisely done. Good job, Johnson. The second part, the conversation itself also I thought was pretty well done. He set the scenario well, you're in a casual function, you're in a Pradyu Dhamma party, and I thought the setup, the initial approach was nicely done. Hey, nice to see you, have a drink of water, you didn't want the water, never mind, let's have a seat. I thought that was very smoothly done because in a party you don't normally start conversation by sitting around, you're moving and you're mingling. I thought that was smoothly done, Johnson. Now, with respect to the 4 levels of conversation, I noticed you started off with small talks, been a while, how's the traffic, small talk. And you actually mentioned, Kai, you talked about viewpoints, how the traffic and all this, how you come here, and you touched a little bit on feelings also. Now, I'd like to cover a little bit on the conversation itself, Johnson. The fact discovery, actually, I thought to a certain extent is more one-sided. You are a very good listener. They say a good listener doesn't speak so much, people don't do it. But I thought a little bit of you were throwing the question, you're not intrusive, and you had very good use of open-ended and close-ended questions. How was it? And he answered, good. What do you feel about it? And then you drew him out one part. That was very nicely done. He had a mixture of open-ended and closed-ended questions. One thing I felt though, as you go through the thing, I felt that to a certain extent, some part, especially the part when you asked him about how's the money and all this, that is, I thought, was veering a little bit into sensitive territory. Some people are sensitive about money. Money is sometimes even more sensitive than sex, honestly speaking. So you have to be a bit careful. Maybe you could have asked something like, oh, you were a financial person before. How do you find it? Is there a big difference in finance? A bit more subtle would have been nice, I thought. Because some people would have cut you off anyway. I don't answer such questions, which I did hear in this club some time ago. Somebody asked a question about salary, and that person said, I don't answer such questions. So it could be a downer in that sense. So you've got to be a little bit careful here. And I thought it would be nice also if you could have shared also Johnson. I thought it was a little bit one-sided. Yes, you are leveraging on the fact that Jonathan has been a few times, but it sounded a little bit to me, it came off a little bit a sort of an interrogation, which does happen in Utama also. Where are you coming from? What do you do? It's like, you know, it's like interrogation, you know, question one, question two. It didn't, I think the part that I thought could improve, Johnson, a little bit of sharing about yourself. Oh, you changed careers. Well, I could change. That's a nice opening for you, John, to say, you know, I made a change of career too, you know. I was just in project management, and now, you know, it'll be nice to have a back and forth. That's what I thought would be a more. Again, I understand the constraints of time and all this. All in all, though, I thought it's an interesting job done, and it's good to hear you speak again, Johnson. Good job. Let's give him a round of applause.
Much that I can add to what you have delivered as an evaluation, but in terms of what we can take away from it, it's a project that I sincerely love because it's in Toastmasters we come, we hear speeches, you know, I was down and I overcome and it's victory again and I'm on the path. But this is something that is real to us in this period that we're living in, where we learn so much about people even before we meet them, because the information is all out there on social media. But it's these steps that were shared that if we can go through those steps when we are having conversations, that's when we establish true relationship, genuine relationship. So I really enjoy that project, and I think this is something that Toastmasters is educational. So we can leave here, at least tonight, that we learned the steps. We knew them before, but we were reminded of the steps that we need to take when we meet others to ensure that we build good relationships. Because it's through conversations and activities that we do. So very, very well done. Our next evaluator, I'm going to get this right now, it's Kai.
No.
Right.
Madam Chair, I really respect your courage to take this opportunity to do this impromptu speech. Shall we give her a round of applause? How to say it. So this assignment, the objective is to how the speaker use the words effectively so they can communicate the message to the audience. So the words basically I use D, J, R, S. What do you mean by D? D is a descriptive words. So during the speech for Madam Chen, she used this descriptive word with humors, like for example, a ladies, a fat lady with 60 kgs, a man running with an umbrella. So all this is really for us to imagine when the speakers share about that speech. J stands for jargon. When we say jargon, it's something like, for example, instead of use interface, we might use talk with. Okay? Another jargon is, instead of use strategize, we might just use a simple word, plan. So in Madam Chen's speech, basically is story. So basically, there is no jargon. So well done. And R stands for rhetorical. What do you mean by rhetorical device? It's like the words that make an ideas for the listeners to remember. For me, I remember your story about the first story that instead of the ladies would lose weight, so at the end is the horse to lose. That is the idea that make you remember that. So lastly, S stands for short and simple words that's easy for the audience to understand. So well done, you have done that as well. And basically, other than these words that use in order to can be deliver the message to the audience, we also have to not forgetting the past three assignments that we have done. How is the organizations? Yeah. So So basically, because it's an impromptu speech, I should say, also well done to you. You have made a good opening by engaging the audience by asking questions. And during the contents, basically, you tell about two interesting story how people do the exercise. Okay? But perhaps in conclusion is very important, because always effective conclusion is for the audience to, what is the take-home message? What is the call for actions for me as an audience to do? So perhaps in your conclusion, you can say that this exercise is very important. So what is the call for actions to do the exercise? So basically, I enjoy your speech. Well done. Thank you.
For new members and our guests, if you ever want to build that skill of public speaking and communication, when you have an opportunity to stand up and speak, you stand up and speak, and that's what I love about your speech. Please vote for the best evaluator. On the point of standing up and speak, I knew you came in as a fill-in, as a hot seat speaker. One of the things I'm going to recommend to you to consider as a club, if you don't have, if you have a speaker that hasn't turned up, is to do what we do in my home club back in Ontario, is that we have a thing that we call dramatically speaking. And it's a very, very fun activity. And if we never had a third speaker this evening, I was going to do it with you. Because what I was going to do is that I was going to help a speaker to construct a speech on the spot. I will come back in a little time and I'll share with you how it's done. But very, very simply is, as a group, we pick a fun topic. We may say a day at the beach, and somebody write it on the book, the speech. So every speech must have a thesis statement or something. So that's it, a day at the beach. To make it fun, we need 3 points, but they don't have to relate to a day at the beach. So it could be, I was walking in the forest and I saw a crow. So it's a day at the beach, that's our title. Our first point is, we're at the beach, but somehow we're walking through the forest and we saw a crow. So we have to build a point on it. Then you add 2 more points, they don't have to relate. What it is very, very fun. It is a fun activity, and it allows the speaker to build a speech on the spot. You get a speaker up here, give them that topic, those 3 points, and they have to speak for 4 to 5 minutes. It is a fun group activity. So if you never have a speaker, try it. All right? So that's what I was going to do with you. So well done again. All right?